the car slips into this strange place, carrying the contents of a cash register. Ah, but things are not what they seem, for this is just a new kind of bank.
Drive-through is actually a fairly old American idea that even Frank Lloyd Wright supposedly once designed a bank where he had the idea of a drive-through window, and the story is that he lost the commission because the bank thought it was totally ridiculous.
Introducing online banking so easy anyone can do it. Pay your bills, manage your accounts, do all your banking from the comfort of your home.
I think the trend has not stopped. I think pretty soon almost all banking will happen online and in an immaterial way.
The Bank of Smithfield, which later became First Citizens Bank, officially opened for business March 1, 1898. During its early years, the bank primarily served agricultural customers and quickly became a successful financial institution. In 1913, with capital and profits of $85,000, the bank hired the firm of J.W. Stout of Sanford, North Carolina, to construct a handsome, brick, neoclassical building. Located on the corner of East Market and 3rd Streets in Smithfield, it served as the home office for First Citizens Bank for 60 years.
In the South, if you look from the 1900s, was terribly capital deprived. The banks were not a service for all people. There was still a lot of bartering, and people didn't have cash, and they didn't need banks, and some of them were suspect of banks.
When you think about the importance of the bank to a small town, it was solidity and permanence, both physically in terms of its structure, because often the banks were the best built buildings in town, and it also meant so though some kind of financial security. We tend to forget the role of capital in developing our communities. And when you think about the limited variety of building types that one would see on Main Street, much of it was retail. There might be a church, or churches might be on the separate church street, which often happened. And if you were lucky enough to be a county seat, there would be a county courthouse somewhere nearby, and there might be a post office. But the bank was one of the most important physical elements to say this town had arrived.
Well, they were typically at the center of the community, and even though they are private buildings, their gestures and their attitude was actually that of a public building compared to a post office or to the city hall or buildings like of that notion. So they acted and looked like and felt like public buildings even though they were private businesses.
The classical language is not the only thing that's important in conveying this sense of solidity and permanence. It was also the use of stone. That stone is a permanent material, it's associated with monumentality, with memory, with a long-term commitment to place. If carving is involved, you can see that there's an intensity of purpose and interest and care, and all of those speak to the issues of we are here for the long term.
In the old bank buildings, you actually didn't mind to wait there a little bit and take in the atmosphere because you felt you were doing something important.
We have to recall that banking was done in person. This is before ATMs, well before online banking, and the transaction took place between person to person in this grand space. We tend to forget that people dressed a little bit when they went into town. There was this sense of occasion if you went to the main street of a town.
If you came to the bank, you dressed up. Ladies would have on gloves and hats. It became a social event. It became a one-time event.
In 1929, the Bank of Smithfield initiated a charter change from a national to a state bank. This resulted in a name change to First Citizens Bank and Trust, and importantly, it enabled the bank to open other branch locations.
We had one building until right after the Depression. Mr. Holden, I think, acquired first a bank in either Benson or Dunn, and the next one followed. They all had sort of a similar look. They were two-story or three-story, and they were about 20 feet wide, and they looked solid.
the earliest appearance of something that we could compare with a bank today is actually in the treasuries of some of the archaeological sites that we visit in Greece. And there is one particular in Delphi that seems to anticipate many of the future images that came. It's a little temple with a pediment with four columns in front of it, and it's very small, but it is really sort of the first bank that we know of.
Even though there's a similarity in the banks in small towns, and it's clear that this is the bank building and we have classical pretensions, they're each different. They're each a little different.
As other banks failed during the Great Depression, First Citizens grew.
Mistolden acquired banks in Beaufort, Fayetteville, then Raleigh.
In 1934, First Citizens Bank purchased the Commercial National Bank building in Raleigh. The 10-story building, by far the largest the bank had yet acquired, was designed in 1912 by the well-known Atlanta-based architect Philip Thornton Mayer. At the time it was built, it was the tallest and most elaborate building in Raleigh.
I really feel it was an example of the period that I would regard one of the best in American architecture. It still had some roots in tradition and in continuity, but there also was an innovative spirit. It was sort of a medium-rise building, which had a fair amount of technology with it, and I felt it was a building that was significant and important for a city like Raleigh and reminded us of where this city was at one time.
First Citizens Bank and Trust Company moved its corporate headquarters from Smithfield to the old Commercial National Bank building in the early 1970s. In 1979, the importance of the building to the historical fabric of Raleigh was recognized by its designation as a Raleigh Historic Property, and in 1980, it was listed as a pivotal building in the Moore Square National Register Historic District. First Citizens Bank and Trust Company remained headquartered in the building until January 1990. The bank planned to destroy the historic building and five adjoining buildings to make way for construction of a new bank headquarters and office tower.
I remember the papers were writing about it, that this is about to happen. There was some controversy whether this was a good idea or not. But the forces that wanted this piece of property and wanted to make room for something else prevailed, and so eventually the building was scheduled for demolition. As I saw the building fall upon itself in dust, my reaction was one of sadness. I think I almost had tears in my eyes. I felt very sad to see this building go. I felt, what a loss.
After demolishing the building, the bank canceled the new building project, and the site stood empty for the next 18 years.
Unfortunately, nothing survives like the pyramids. The internal structure starts rotting, decaying, the windows collapse and rot. So the exterior will be there, the granite probably forever, but there's a certain replacement philosophy in this country. You know, you go to Europe and they don't tear things down.
In Europe, we have buildings, bank buildings, that are 600 years old and, it's gleaming with computers. Everything works just fine.
A lot of those buildings, those banks, are located in established central business districts, full of historic buildings. In order to add parking or a drive-in lane next to the building, usually you have to take out a historic building.
In the United States, I think the car has really driven the banks to seek locations that are accessible by car, and by definition, that will not be possible in a downtown location. So I think the best we can do is try to preserve the buildings, but perhaps find some other uses for them because they are good buildings. I don't think, if existing example serves, the kinds of buildings that have gone up in place of the ones that have been turned down, in my opinion, without exception, have been worse.
You end up with a representation of solidity on a building that really has not been built to last. And I think people understand the difference.
We build our branches for permanence, but with some flexibility. It's easier to knock a hole in fiberglass than it is granite.
It is like, you know, you extinguish a piece of memory in your brain that is not there anymore. Something that we have forgotten. And I feel it's one of the important functions of architecture to be the materialized external memory of a community. And the advantage is that we all experience them together. We have the same frame of reference. It's not our personal memories that we carry around in our head, but it's the memory that we share as a community that is materially given that we experience on an everyday basis. And so from that point of view, once the building is gone, something has been extinguished. Yeah. I don't think they can be replaced, no.
Older city forms with their permanent buildings remind us that there are other ways to live. And I don't think it's an accident that so many Americans like to go on their free time to small towns where they can walk up and down the street and shop and feel like they are somewhere. And so preserving the structure, the organization, the place of our small towns with their bank building as being a part of it is important to us to provide an opportunity for rethinking how we live in the future.
Jeune danse, des montres, jeune menteur.
Well, I think we still recognize them as good buildings. And I think anytime we have a good building, you are reluctant to tear it down, so you find another use for it. I think we have many times felt that if you build the building well and beautifully, even if it loses its function, somebody will find a different use for it. And I think banks belong to that category.